Now it is my distinct pleasure to introduce a good friend, Jim Long, who is our speaker for the day. He's an avid genealogist for over 35 years and has deep roots in Middle Tennessee. A Clarksville native and Franklin resident, he's a volunteer at the Stewart County Archives and has published 9 books of Stewart County genealogical records in support of his goal to increase access to original records for fellow researchers. He currently serves as president of the Middle Tennessee Genealogical Society, or MTGS, and won its Writers Award in 2014 for an article published in our MTGS journal about Civil War graffiti he discovered while volunteering at the Stewart County Archives. He's a lifetime member of the Montgomery County Historical Society and is the webmaster for the Tennessee State Library and Archives Friends. Jim is a graduate of Vanderbilt University and holds a bachelor's degree in mathematics and computer science. He maintains the websites for not only the Friends, but also the Middle Tennessee Genealogical Society, as well as the Tennessee GenWeb County's websites for Stewart and Montgomery counties. When he's not doing genealogy, which is quite rare, Jim works, this is every day, he's got to make a living somehow. he works as an IT application analyst at the General Motors plant in Spring Hill, Tennessee. So it is indeed my pleasure to introduce you to Jim Long for his presentation.
Thank you, Virginia. Let's do another quick sound check. Can y'all hear me okay? Great, great. As Virginia said, I have a passion about uniting people with records that will help them in their research. I love doing my own genealogy, don't get me wrong, but I really enjoy getting people closer to the records that will help them in their research projects. So I'm going to go through today 3 case studies of research projects that I've done here at TSLA. One of them is historical, and the other 2 tend to be more genealogical. But I want to focus on the records that I used in those 3 case studies, those projects. We'll meet some people along the way, but this talk is really about the records. What records are here? Where do you find them? How do you use them? Or maybe if you already know about them, I might give you a way to use them in a way you haven't thought about before. And I'm going to point out some of my favorite records here as we go along. So the first case study I want to talk to you about is on a topic, historical topic, pioneer horse racing in Montgomery County. This was a topic that I had not been researching. It just fell out of the blue for me. And some of you may have heard a presentation I gave up at Clarksville last year talking about horse racing in and of itself. This talk is about how I researched that topic in that presentation. So it's a records-based talk. But it did lead me through quite a variety of records here at TSLA, and it all started with a clue. And that was a Google Books search from one of my ancestors' names. If you haven't done a Google Books search for each of your ancestors' names, you need to, because it can take you to some amazing places. So I did a Google book search for my ancestor's name, and you can see I typed Reuben Pollard in quotation marks up there just to see what might come back. And the first few results, Nantucket, that didn't line up. This is an ancestor that for me was in Montgomery County. But that third one down really jumped off the page at me, and I've enlarged it here for you. Making the American Thoroughbred, especially in Tennessee, a book written in 1916, and you can see Clarksville Jockey Club. Well, of course, I fell out of my chair then because my guy lived in Montgomery County, and he was in the early 1800s. You see the date 1837 there, so I knew this was probably my guy, right? This was not the first page of search results, so when you go do your searches, make sure you hit page 2 and 3 and 4 until they're maybe not the end of the internet, but do keep searching. And keep in mind spelling variations too. So this was my clue that got me started, okay? Well, this is a book that is electronically available on Google, but hey, TSLA is a library. They've got this book here, right? So here's the book at TSLA that I asked them to pull for me, and I show you there a highlight of that little snippet we found on Google Books where it mentions my ancestor, Reuben Pollard, was one of the judges for the Clarksville Jockey Club, whatever that was, right? This was a book I had to have pulled, but the TSLA catalog will tell you about all the books that are here, even if it's not one you can go pull off the shelf. So just have the staff pull a book for you, and you don't know what you're going to find in there. So when I saw this, I formulated three questions that I wanted to know more about my ancestor and this topic. Where were these horse races held? How long did racing go on there? And did my ancestor, my guy, Reuben Pollard, own one of the racehorses? Okay, that's what I want to find out as I go through this, right? This same book gives us a clue as to where the races were held. That's one of my questions. So in that book, it says, at the Woodlawn Course, 1.5 miles from Clarksville. Awesome. Well, if you know Clarksville, there are two rivers, and it doesn't say what direction upstream or downstream from Clarksville this was. So this isn't a perfect clue. There are actually 6 different places this might have been, depending on whether it was upstream or downstream and whether it was on the Cumberland or the Red River. But it's a clue. Okay, it's a place to start. So, but what I really, really want to know is where the races were. Where was that racetrack, right? So the question then was, what resources here could help me answer that question and the other questions that I'd formulated? So one place that I might go would be county records. This is a piece of land I'm looking for, so maybe deed books can help me. But I don't know who owned the racetrack, so how do I find them in the deed book? And I'm certainly not going to read every page of the deed books in this time period to try to stumble on something. Tax records might have been a good way to search, but there wasn't a special tax on horse racing tracks at the time, so it's unlikely I'm going to find something there that fills in this topic for me. So what I really navigated to is, where could I find here contemporary accounts of what was going on in that 1830s time period? And that leads me to the wonderful newspaper collection here at TSLA, the biggest collection of Tennessee newspapers on microfilm that you're going to find anywhere. So how do we get to that? So from the TSLA website, click on Library and Archives, or hover on it rather, click on History and Genealogy. You get this main page, and we'll be coming to this page a lot today. And then at the very bottom, you see newspapers, right? So if you click on that, you get an index, A through Z, where you're going to click on a city name. I clicked C for Clarksville, because this is a Clarksville newspaper I'm interested to know more about. And I do see that there's not a Clarksville paper, but there's a Nashville paper for the time period I'm interested in. Maybe I'll go look there. Not that far from Clarksville. I didn't find any Clarksville papers. Oh, excuse me, I did find a Clarksville paper. I jumped ahead. So there was a Clarksville Chronicle, one issue from 1834, and then there was some more issues, very broken and scattered, just a few issues in 39, all of 1840 and a little bit in 1847. I did also search the Nashville papers, and I do say that there is a much better selection of Nashville papers during the time period that I'm interested in. Okay. And it makes sense for this particular topic that they may have advertised these horse races in the Nashville paper to get the city folk to come out to Clarksville for the races. So I pulled the Nashville paper, crank away through the microfilm, and fortunately, there was a nice picture of a horse race that helped me find this little gem from 1836, that the races over the Woodlawn Course near Clarksville commence on the 20th. So I was able to find out that, yeah, the Woodlawn was the name of the course, and races were going on in 1836. There's a little bit there about the prizes for it. So I'm finding some things out about this topic. But I had to crank through the Nashville papers to stumble on that. That took a little bit of time, right? But I've been a little dishonest with you already, and I do apologize for that. It didn't take me hours to find this, because if you're searching in Nashville newspapers in the 1800s, there is a resource you need to know about, and it is one of my absolute favorites, and you can only use it here in the building. Okay, so at the public computers, you're going to click on newspapers. And you're going to get a list of newspaper collections here. This first one, the 19th century newspapers, is one you can actually get to from home if you're a Tennessee resident. The one I want to talk about here that I've got the gold star around because it's one of my favorites is this Nashville Newspapers, 1812 to 1922 collection. Okay, easily searchable in red letters, wonderful index of not only the original images, but an index to those images. The TEL we'll talk about a little bit later, but for now I'm focusing on this Nashville newspaper collection that you can only look at while you're in the building. So when you click on that, you get a little search box, an explanation of what this collection is about, which is Nashville newspapers over a wide, wide date range, right? So what do I do here? Well, what I know so far is these races I was interested in finding out about were at a track called Woodlawn, okay? So I type Woodlawn in the search box and hit the little magnifying glass and see what happens. Now, the first result that came back seemed to be something about the post office. Not too interesting. It's an 1820 record. But then I start getting in 1834 just a lot of links to something. I don't know what this is, so I'm just going to click on that first one and see what classified ad number four means. And boom, there's that same article that I could have found eventually by cranking through all that microfilm, but by searching for the word Woodlawn that I knew about, and notice how this ProQuest database even highlights your search field for you. I could get to this same information much, much quicker through that ProQuest database. I really love it. And with this ProQuest database on these public computers, you can save these images to your flash drive or print them out there at the printers. I love, love, love this collection. Like any good search engine, you want to broaden your search, so I'll search for both Woodlawn with no space and Woodlawn with a space, okay? You may get different results that way. But again, using that ProQuest database, find things much more quickly. A little bit more about this database. You can sort the search results by date, if that helps you with your search, and you can also narrow the results by date. I didn't do any filters, and it would have taken me a while to get through 1,182 results if I didn't kind of focus in on the date to the time period I was kind of researching. And this database, as I'll show you in a minute, kind of contained the breakthrough information that I needed for this topic I was researching about horse racing in Montgomery County in the 1830s. And what I found was this little gem, again, searching for the word Woodlawn. In the Nashville Banner for the 1841, I see that the Woodlawn racetrack land is for sale. The F didn't come through there, but that's for sale. Okay. So in 1841, this land is being sold. It's 400 acres, and I get a little clue immediately on the Cumberland, so I know it's on the river, and it's 2 miles above Clarksville. Hey, I'm zeroing in on that location that I really want to find, but I'm not quite there yet. And what really was the breakthrough is that it told me who owned this piece of land. D. Burris owned this land in 1841. So with that name, now I'm ready to go to the deed books and try to find the deeds that talk about this piece of land. So how do you do that? County records on microfilm, one of the largest collections on microfilm here, are these county records. And hopefully you all recognize this little carol. Hopefully you use it a lot. There's an in-county microfilm index for every county in this little carol. And I give you an example here of the Montgomery County book. And what I'm really interested in now, since I want to trace this piece of land that this racetrack was on, is I want to go look at the deed index. So here it says deed book index, direct and reverse, roll number 102. So now I can go immediately to that Montgomery County microfilm, pull out roll 102, and look for this David D. Burris. I think his name was David, and try to find this piece of land, find where this land was changing hands and what else might be in the deed books. So on that microfilm, sure enough, in the index, book O, pages 188 and 189, there is David Burris, who is buying two different pieces of land. So now I can jump immediately to that deed book, and here's what it says. This is George Nelson selling some land to David Burris, and it's 400 acres. That matches what was in that newspaper article, so that's a good sign, right? I don't know who George Nelson is, but he was one of those owners in that newspaper clipping that I first showed you. He owned one of the horses. Well, if he was rich enough to own horses, he was probably rich enough to own the land that the horses raced on. So this is a good sign. 400 acres of land. A little more in there, and look at that. The Woodlawn Course. It's the place on which Nelson lives and the Woodlawn Course. So right there in the deed book, this racetrack I'm looking for is there. I had never seen this before in all my years of researching. I'd never seen this phrase in these deed books to note that there was a race course there. So I was thrilled to find this. And I never could have done this without that ProQuest newspaper clipping that you can only do here. It's an important part of it. Again, I want to know the exact location of this piece of land. So I need to keep going. Okay. And also in this same deed, I get another clue that it's bounded on the west boundary of a 640-acre grant granted by North Carolina to Samuel Mason. Don't know who Samuel Mason is, but this is my next clue. In order to find out where that piece of land is, Samuel Mason is a clue for me. North Carolina grant is a clue for me. This is an 1830s deed. The North Carolina grants were 40 years old by then. So what I really needed to do then was figure out, how do I learn more about this land grant? This piece, this Samuel Mason grant, so that I can pinpoint it on a map, figure out where this race course really was. So where do we go here at TSLA for North Carolina land grant information? We go to another of my favorite collections, Microfilm Group 1177. These are North Carolina Secretary of State Land Grant Office warrants, surveys, and related documents. This is the land record information for what became Tennessee. Wonderful, wonderful collection. Hundreds of rolls of microfilm, as we'll see. Lots of little pieces of paper, and I'll show you what those look like. The records, it's important to know how this collection is organized. It's organized by county or district where the grants were located. Okay, this piece of land I'm looking for is in Montgomery County. Do I jump to the Montgomery County microfilm and start cranking? No, I don't, because I'm not going to find it there. So what we really need for this collection, because these are arranged only by county and district, I'm looking for Samuel Mason. That's all I've got. Samuel Mason, Montgomery County. How am I going to find him? There is a wonderful, wonderful index to this record collection. And it's a book by Irene Griffey of Clarksville called Earliest Tennessee Land Records and Earliest Tennessee Land History. If you want to know anything about the early land history of Tennessee, read Irene's book. And if you're familiar downstairs with the microfilm cabinets where the vital records are, this is that cabinet, and I've got a little arrow there pointing to Irene's book, so you can find it easily. This is the best source I know of for getting into that record 1177 group to search for somebody by name. So here's an example of what wonderful thing Irene has done in making this book. Is by name for who got the land grant, you'll get a county and a file number, and with those two pieces of information, you can go find those original documents in this microfilm collection. I'm looking for Samuel Mason because he was a neighbor, apparently, of this racetrack I'm looking for, and so I see Davidson County, not Montgomery County, because at the time he got this grant, there was no Montgomery County, so I've got to go look in Davidson County, file number 1257. You see that this piece of land is on the north side of the Cumberland River. That is comforting because that's the area I'm focusing on. So if I load up Davidson County 1257, let me show you how to find that. If you open the drawer where 1177 is contained, you can see these Davidson County reels, and each one has a number. So I'm looking for Davidson County 1257. Can you see how it's going to be on that little roll of microfilm I've got pulled there? So that's the roll of microfilm I need because I'm looking for Davidson County 1257. So if I jump there, each one of these files on this collection will be preceded by this little card, and this is not an old card. This is the card that was made to index these records. But at the very top, you'll see 1257, which is the file number I'm looking for. Samuel Mason's name. So yeah, this is the one I want. So if I crank through the microfilm there, here's a typical example of what you're going to see in this 1177 group. You're going to see a warrant, and I don't have it transcribed here for you, but this is basically the document that North Carolina issued that said Samuel Mason was entitled to this land grant. And I do underline his name there so you can see it. The other thing you see in here are plats of the actual land. Wonderful, wonderful thing to have. Bad copy here. I'm going to draw in what you can't see. It gives you a plat of that land to scale. This one has a little squiggly line going through it. It's suggesting some sort of water course. And this is not written the way we would expect with north pointing up, but they tell you in these plats which way north is. So here's a little puzzle piece. Let's call this a puzzle piece for Samuel Mason's land grant. Okay. So I'm narrowing in on what I really want is the location of this racetrack. But Samuel Mason was just a neighbor, right? He wasn't the one who sold the land that had the racetrack on it. That was a Mr. Nelson. If I go back to Irene's book and look at Nelson, there's two pages of Nelson's. Oh, gosh. What am I going to do here? Well, I can do a little bit of filtering here because the water courses are listed over here. And if I see Harpeth River, I'm probably not going to go look that one up. I'm going to focus on the ones that say Cumberland River because that's where I know this racetrack was. So it's possible. I did this. Loaded up each one of these looking for a Nelson man getting a grant on the Cumberland River that seemed to be in the location I was looking for. And actually found two of them. And I'll show them to you. Here's a much better picture of what one of these plats looks like. You can see that Robert Nelson had 640 acres. Beautiful drawing of the Cumberland River here. A little water course. I love this here. That says the Beaver Pond. And more importantly, this one says that it's adjoining Samuel Mason's boundary. So I have found a puzzle piece that fits next to that other puzzle piece that I started out with. So you see where I'm going with these puzzle pieces? So Samuel Mason's land is basically, his grant was there, and here's one from Robert Nelson. So I've got two pieces of that puzzle put together. I'm zeroing in on where this racetrack really was located. Another one I found, also Robert Nelson, in the Davidson County file, is another piece of land that also mentions Samuel Mason as a neighbor. So now I found a third puzzle piece. So I can put all these together, right, to try to pinpoint where this racetrack was really located. And oh, by the way, this, it's hard to read, but that says Pleasant Garden Path. Find all sorts of little tidbits in these plats of these North Carolina land grants. So now it's time to put these three puzzle pieces together. So there are my three grants that I've drawn. They were drawn to different scales, so I had to do a little bit of sizing. But can you in your mind see the Cumberland River flowing from here to here? Can you complete that course? You can see. So I knew that the land I was interested in was here. It's next to Samuel Mason's land, right? So let's put that next to a modern map. And look what happens. It just falls right out there. That bend of the river, that bend. So now I know that racetrack land was right there. And I can go to that place. There's a road that goes right by it through that river bottom. That was a wonderful discovery for me in researching this project, was to be able to know exactly where that piece of land was, where that racetrack was. So every time I drive by here, when I look out in that river bottom, I can hear the horses racing. I love it, love it. Those of you that are familiar with Clarksville, this is the Cunningham Bridge, and the Catfish House is right there. Great place to eat. Now, I've been in the North Carolina land grants here showing you how to find these puzzle pieces, how you can maybe stitch them together to find current location of the map. There are a series of books that has done this for you. It's called Founding the Cumberland Settlements. Copies are here. The gentleman who did that used Irene's book, used this same collection to kind of map those out. I like the old records. I like doing it this way. But those books are an amazing work as well. So use those as you can as well. The one thing I would say about those books, though, is they didn't always put the name of the original land grant holder on there. So if you use those books, just keep that in mind, but both are a wonderful technique, and I would encourage you to explore this record collection, 1177. Okay, so back to this book that started this particular search, and let's see how I did on answering my questions. Where were the races held? Hey, figured that out. All right. How long did racing go on there? We saw that newspaper clipping that he had to sell the land in 1841. Don't find anything in the newspapers after that, so he must have just not made a go of operating that racetrack and had to sell the land. 400 acres is quite a lot to not have under cultivation if you're trying to make a living. I didn't find my third question, though. Did my guy, Reuben Pollard, own a horse? Did not find that. Don't know the answer to that still. But I did find something else here at TSLA about this guy that I do want to share with you because it lets me talk about another record collection here at TSLA and brag on my guy a little bit. And that are the legislative petitions. You get to those by clicking, opening up the legislative records category on the TSLA website and clicking on legislative records. So the petitions came from all over the state and a wide variety of topics. You think about anything that a group of citizens may get up in arms about and want the legislature to go change. So you might see a petition to support navigation on the Red River, and you might see another one to oppose navigation on the Red River. You might see divorces because divorces were granted by the state legislature early. So legislative records are great. And let me show you how to use those. You know, on the website here, there's a great search engine, but it doesn't search everything on the website. Legislative records are part of that. So when you click on legislative records and then click on legislative petitions, you get a list of the petitions that are there. And you see that they're grouped by year range. When you click on each of these are PDF files, and those PDF files are not part of the search engine. So you will want to open each of these individually and search on whatever it is you're looking for in that time period. Maybe a name, maybe a county. Okay, so what I did was I opened each one of these looking for my guy, Reuben Pollard, and I actually found him in 1832-33 petitions, and let me show you what that looked like. This is one of the PDF files that you'll find on the website, not part of the index, but look here. My guy's name, Reuben Pollard, was indexed on some sort of petition from friends of Robert Wells, who was an Indian fighter requesting relief. But my guy was also indexed. Now, these are petitions. They contain, in many cases, hundreds of signatures. Not all of those signatures are indexed. So that's why you may, when you're going through the petitions, you may just need to look for the county. And if you're researching in Montgomery County, you may want to pull every petition that has something to do with that county because your ancestor may be listed in one of those hundreds of signatures in one of those petitions, and it won't be here in this nice PDF index. So you have to do a little digging here. But these petitions are all on microfilm. They are in the bottom of that same cabinet I showed you earlier with Irene's books sitting on the top. They're in the bottom drawer of that cabinet. So let's look at the petition that mentions my guy, Reuben Pollard. One of the wonderful things is that these petitions are here. Ask and they will bring it to you. And here's me about to enjoy looking at the petition that's got my guy mentioned in it somehow. If you put the gloves on like they ask you, they'll even let you touch it. So what's in this petition? My ancestor's original signature. I love finding original signatures. For me, they are the next best thing to a photograph of that person. And this is someone who died in the 1840s. I got no chance of finding a photograph, maybe a portrait. But my guy's listed here. He signed it. I'm touching the document that he signed. I love that. And I would have been happy if that's all this petition had said about my guy. But look what else it says. This is a petition supporting Robert Wells, an Indian fighter, who's well known as having fought manfully in the Indian skirmishes. And who can particularly attest to that? Reuben Pollard, who is well known to us, a man of veracity. So my guy was a man of veracity in the eyes of his neighbors. And that may have been what qualified him as a judge at the horse races. He was an honest guy. So I would have been thrilled just to see his signature. Doubly thrilled. You don't know what you're going to find until you dig in these legislative petitions and see what's there. I would encourage you to do that. And again, those are not part of the search engine of the website. This petition had hundreds of signatures in it. So I actually found two other original signatures of two other ancestors that signed this same thing. Okay. in review what we saw in this case study. Started out with the Google Books search for my ancestor's name. You're all going to go home and do that, right? Actually, pull the books here at TSLA and look at them, because you don't know what you're going to find in them. The ProQuest database. Love, love, love that one. You can only access it here on site. And that database was the missing link to finding out where that racetrack land was and who owned it. I talked a little bit about the county microfilm inventories, how that helped me access the deed books. I'll talk a little bit more about that in the third case study. Spend some time in the 1177 microfilm group and use Irene's book as your guide to accessing those records. And then lastly, those petitions that are going to have original signatures of your ancestor, hopefully, or at the very least might help you learn more about one of those ancestors. So in this one, I started out with the clue of his name, and I ended up finding his original signature. Love it, love it. Okay, I'm going to switch gears here. So like I said, I've got three case studies, and they're in different PowerPoints, so bear with me just a second. Okay, so the second case study I wanted to take you through is about identifying people in an old photo. If you're lucky, like me, you may have a couple of family photos that actually have names written on them. Most of them don't. I got lucky on a couple of mine here. This one here says Aunt Hattie Luton and Uncle Pink. And then in different script it says Papa or Hattie Free, Papa's sister. So not only did I get names, I got genealogy on there. It's an exception. This is the easy one. I want to take you through a difficult one. Here's a photo that came in my family with nothing on it but a blue X. And I'm going to zoom in on it. And here are the questions I formulated when I saw this. Okay, when was the photo made, and who are the guys in the picture? To me, the garments were distinctive. I thought they were Masonic when I first looked at them. There are 23 people in the photo. They're all men. That's a clue. And our only other clue is a blue X on one guy. Well, that one guy is someone I fortunately do know, because that's how this picture was in my family. His name is George Washington Wallace II. I'll show you the dates there. He lived his entire life in the same house, and that's a clue. Some other clues is that we have other family pictures of him. I want to know more about this picture. I know that the dates on these pictures. So, you know, eyeballing it, maybe this picture is closer in time to that time frame than that one, but I don't know. But that's what I want to know. I want to know when this picture was made, and I want to know the names of everybody in that picture. Okay? Given the fact that this guy was born and died in the same house in the same little town in Stewart County, and the family tradition was he was a Mason, the next clue is that there was a Masonic lodge in that little bitty town. It was called Lineport Lodge. So I can surmise that the photo I'm interested in is very likely of Lineport Lodge members. Not for sure. That's what I want to find out. And so my question is, who's everyone else in the photo? When was the photo made? More importantly, while we're here, what resources here at TSLA can help me figure this out? Okay, so I'm going to go to the TSLA website search engine. I'm going to type in Lineport Lodge, and I'm going to have all my questions answered. No. No. With any search engine, TSLA is no exception. If you don't find results, make your search less specific. So instead of searching for Lineport Lodge, let's go back and just search for the word Masonic. Hey, we found a good hit here. Look at this one. Collection 1967, Masonic Grand Lodge of Tennessee, annual returns of local lodges. Huge time range there. 134 reels of microfilm here, just on Masonic records. As with any collection at TSLA that is more than one reel of microfilm, look on the first one, because there's a strong chance of there being a finding aid on that reel number one. And where else, if you've never searched this before, where else would you start but reel one anyway? So let's look at reel one of record 1967. Finding aid, great, this is what we want, to tell us how the records are organized. They're organized by lodge number. Well, I don't know his lodge number. Hundreds of pages have been preserved for lots of lodges. That's a good sign. An index to lodges by location and name is in the finding aid. Now, that's what I need. I know the location, Stewart County, I know the name, but the records are organized by lodge number, okay? So here's the index of lodges by number. Doesn't take me that long to crank through that reel one to find Lineport Lodge, Bumpus Mills, Stewart County. Happens to be lodge number 207, and it is on microfilm reel 35. So now I can jump immediately to reel number 35 in those 100 reels and see more about this particular lodge that I want to know more about. Here's an example of Lineport Lodge, one of the records on there from 1857, a listing of the names of the members of that lodge. Now, my guy wasn't born until 1863, so this is too early for him, but it shows you the kind of records you're likely to find in this collection. The first list of men had initials by them, and I didn't know. I educated myself. I didn't know what those initials stood for, but they are abbreviations for the officers of that lodge, and here are what those initials stood for. Each member of that lodge had a different role, and those were listed as well as the regular membership. Okay. So I did a little bit of an internet search to learn more about those offices, because I thought that might be helpful. And I ran into this, and I didn't know anything about Masonic records, but I learned that the officers in the lodge each had unique jewels, as they were called, to signify their office. And that made me remember something in that photo. Some of the men in this photo were wearing officer jewels. So now I know, don't know their names, but I know their offices, okay? I'm getting closer, right? Made some progress here. Still don't know who they are, still don't know when it was taken, but I do know that these were the officers of that lodge whenever this picture was made, okay? So let's jump back into the records for Lineport Lodge and see what we find there. The only guy we know so far is my guy, G.W. Wallace, okay? So in those records here at TSLA, we see that G.W. Wallace was initiated in 1896 to this lodge. For that year, here's a list of the officers for the lodge the year he was initiated. Hey, all right, we're done, right? We know everybody. No, we don't know that the photo was made the year he joined, right? We've got to keep looking. And this guy, was a member from 1896 until he died in 1940. Got a lot of records yet to look through. So I don't yet know when the photo was taken, but hopefully you see where I'm going. I know who the officers were by their jewels, and I'm going to find in these records their names, okay? But as I showed you a little early, there's a quiz. I hope they warned you about this, that there was going to be a quiz. True or false, Tennessee did not begin keeping death records statewide until 1908. Well, it's kind of true because I put statewide in there, but the big cities did keep death records, okay? There are the dates for those. We're not in a big city, though. We're in Little Bumpus Mills, Tennessee. Next quiz question. True or false? With the exception of those four cities listed in the first question, you won't find death records anywhere in Tennessee before 1908. False. Masonic records have deaths in them. In addition to listing when members were initiated, there's also a list of deaths. I show you here from the Lineport Lodge a man named Dawsey Griffin, and in the deaths column, it says that he died February 2nd, 1869, 40 years before death records existed statewide. Okay. So I wanted to know a little bit more about Dawsey Griffin. Do his descendants know this is when he died? He does not have a tombstone. I found the cemetery where he's buried, so I did a bit of an ancestry search to see if his descendants knew this date, and they don't. What they know is the date that his estate, his executor's bond, was made in the county court system. So his descendants don't know that this is the day he died. But here it is, right here. It's downstairs. Just go load that microfilm, and you can see it. Right. So that's one of the reasons I love these Masonic records, is you're going to find 19th century death information that you're not going to find anywhere else. Now, not everybody was a lodge member, but if you suspect you had an ancestor who was, hopefully you see that you can fairly easily jump to the county they lived in, look through the lodge records of those lodges in that county, and maybe find something about your person of interest that you didn't know before. Certainly, I'm going to be seeking out the descendants of Dossie Griffin to share this information with them. Other things that you can find in Masonic records: B.J. Crowder was expelled from Lineport Lodge in 1870 for gross un-Masonic conduct. Now, when I saw this name, I recognized it. Because in February 1870, 1 month prior, B.J. Crowder had been indicted by the grand jury for living with a woman who was not his wife. And that woman was my ancestor. In the 1880 census, she is listed with his last name. He's not around, but I never found a marriage record for them, so I don't know. But the point here is that these records that are downstairs can have some other interesting information in them. Okay, back to the photo that I wanted to learn more about. So my guy, Wallace, was initiated in 1896. Like I said, he lived for 44 more years as a member of this lodge. So I need to keep moving forward in time and look at other records. So let's look at 1897. Here's 1897 records for this lodge. And my guy, G.W. Wallace, was treasurer of the lodge in 1897. Well, back in the photo, he's not wearing the treasurer jewels. This other guy is. So my photo isn't 1897. Hey, that's progress. I have eliminated 1 year that my photo probably isn't. Okay? So you see where I'm going with that. So if I continued going through these lodge records year by year, and I was able to compile this list year by year from the time he joined, who all the officers were and who the regular members were. Okay, got some good information. I can do something with this, right? But I have a few years I can eliminate. I talked already about 1897. He was a treasurer. He's not wearing the treasurer's jewels in that photo. So I can eliminate 1897, okay? There are a few other years, likewise. He's an officer in some of these other years. He's not wearing jewels in the picture, so I can eliminate those years, okay? So you see where I'm going with this. Process of elimination. Hey, I can figure this out. I can go year by year, but there's another piece that I'm missing because I still don't know the names of these guys. I know the choices. It's some of these people on this page here, but I don't know who's who. So the other piece of this that I used in this project is the apparent ages of these guys in the photo, okay? This is, I'm guessing, around 1900. So I'm going to use the census. I'm going to find these guys in the census and see how old they were in the census, okay? So here's, I've added a little to the spreadsheet. So for the officers, the ones that are wearing the jewels, I've noted their ages in that year. And this is all based on how old they were when I found them in the 1900 census. So now what can I do? Well, let's look at this guy on the very end. He appears to be the oldest of the officers. And he's wearing the jewels as the senior deacon. Well, the senior deacon during this time was various men, but you see their ages? They're all much younger than this guy. So in my mind, that means I can eliminate all of these years because the data doesn't match. I don't have a senior deacon that looks as old as that guy. Okay, so you see what I'm doing there? So through this same process, looking year by year at all the members, looking at their census ages, trying to figure out at least who the officers are by name, I eliminated every possible year. I don't know. I thought sure something would fall out of this, but I just couldn't make it work. For each of these years, I found a reason to eliminate that year based on somebody being the wrong age but wearing the wrong jewels in that picture. And sincerely, you're probably expecting this to have a happy ending, but it doesn't. We don't always in our genealogical searches have a happy ending. So I've got to regroup and try something else, take another look at this data. But I feel like this technique, using the records here with telling me who the people were in the lodge, is going to help me figure it out. One of the things I need to do is I need to contact this lodge. It's still in existence. For all I know, I could walk in their front door and this picture's hanging on the wall with everybody's name on it. I need to do that. But this was the fun way to do it and to access a record collection here at TSLA that isn't used that often. I would encourage you to look at the Masonic records. So in this one we saw that Masonic records can find things that you can't find anywhere else. Early death records, you can find gross un-Masonic conduct. I give you again there the 1967, that's the number you're going to need to go find this downstairs. Also, as we saw with the TSLA search engine, be prepared to revise your search to be less specific when you need to, and you can find more things. Also, that it takes multiple collections to attempt some projects. It took a combination of the photo plus the Masonic records plus the census records to even attempt what I'm still trying to do. Okay. And then we also learned that not every genealogy story has a happy ending. Okay, I'm going to switch here to my last one. Okay, so in that last case study, I did not give you a happy ending. But this one is called A Genealogy Story with a Happy Beginning. So hopefully I will make up for not having a happy ending to the last story. Okay, I am researching in my home county, Montgomery County, minding my own business, looking at the 1830 census, and looking at the original records, not somebody's transcription online. And I come across that entry there. A woman named Happy Self in the 1830 census. Very interesting. The name itself jumped out of the page at me. Okay, it's not a name I'm familiar with. But look at the census data for her. This appears to be a white female in her 20s, living alone. I'll show you the next page of the census as no enslaved people in her household, no free persons of color, just Happy. What is a 20-year-old woman doing living by herself in Montgomery County? Well, I had to know. This is not one of my ancestors. This is just a name that jumped out at me, and she made me want to learn more about her. So this case study is about how you go about using TSLA records when all you have is a name, okay? How do you work your way through all of the wonderful records here when all you've got is a name and a place, okay? Those of you that are advanced genealogists, intermediate genealogists, this can be a good exercise too to sharpen your skills because it gets rid of all of those inhibitions you may have. You see a name, a county you're familiar with, may lead you in one specific direction. If you start with somebody you don't know, a place you don't know, you're going to do the genealogy better that way, okay? You're going to be more thorough. Okay, so where do we start learning more about Happy Self? First, let me just tell you the questions I formulated here. Was Self her maiden name? I wanted to know that. Don't know that name myself. Who was her family? She was living alone. Where's the rest of her family? And then, ultimately, what happened to her? Okay. So census records are a great place to start when you are starting somewhere. Here at TSLA, you can use the public computers to access the Ancestry Library Edition. Easy way to access census images if you don't have a subscription of some sort, like an Ancestry at home. Use the public computers here and access the indexes and images. But always look at the originals, not just the indexes. It's so important to understand, especially with Ancestry, the person who indexed the records wasn't from around here. So that index may not be all that good. Okay? So always head towards the original images like I showed you there to start with. Okay. Also look for bound indexes or transcriptions in the reading room downstairs. because those are more likely to have been created by someone who knew that county. They're going to do a better job of transcribing that county records. So use the two together. Ancestry or online sites are an easy way to access the information, but don't take their indexes for gospel. Lean as best you can more towards locally created indexes. Okay, now, in addition to the public computers, if you're a resident of Tennessee, you can view the images online for free, whether you have a subscription or not, through the Tennessee Electronic Library that Virginia mentioned earlier. If you go to the TSLA website, click on the TEL link on the main page of the archives, then you'll click on a genealogy tab and then a Heritage Quest online tab. And I don't show you a shot of what that looks like here, but that's what you need to know if you want to be able to access census images from home for free if you're a Tennessee resident. So in these census records, I was looking for other censuses with Happy Self listed in them, and I didn't find any. By the 1840 census, I presume she's either married or dead. Don't know. Couldn't find her. So where else, what other types of records might I find her in? Marriage records are another easy, basic way to start a search for somebody like this. But with marriage records, you have to search county by county, their county records. And oh, by the way, Montgomery County, where I found her, their records don't start till 1838. Okay, it actually wasn't a state law until 1838 that the marriages had to be recorded in a well-bound book, as the statute says. Okay. But the county marriage records are all here on microfilm. You can access them. But again, look for published transcriptions in the reading room as a quicker way to not have to crank through reels and reels of microfilm for marriage records. Now, also available here on the public computers, TSLA's marriage collection on Ancestry is available here on the public computers. I would call it a quick and dirty index to all of the county marriage records. And it's only a good index if you find what you're hoping to find. Not a great index, but if you're looking for something specific and you find it, then hey, it was a great index. Okay. The marriage records are, though, not available through TEL, so you do, if you don't have a subscription to Ancestry, you'll have to use them on the public computers here. But I'm going to try. I'm going to use the Quick and Dirty Ancestry Index on the computers downstairs for a woman named Happy Self, and I put in 1830 because that's when I found her, and Montgomery County because that's where I found her. And hey, we actually found something, so this is a great index because I found what I was looking for. Happy Self married Reuben Dixon in Dixon County, adjacent to Montgomery. That's a good sign. There's a little bit of an issue with the dates here, though. Two sets of dates, and they're a year apart. I'm going to have to resolve that conflict somehow. But with this information, I can jump into the original records. I can go downstairs and pull the Dixon County marriage records for this time period, and boom, here is on roll 158 of the Dixon County records, here is the license for Reuben Dixon to marry Happy Self, issued by the county court clerk of Dixon County. And this one says 1831, so the license was issued 1831. Another important clue on this loose record is that Happy Self had to be an actual resident of this county. So that tells me she has, since the time of the Montgomery County 1830 census, she's apparently moved over the line to Dixon. Okay, that's a good clue. Also on the microfilm here, a second document. This is the marriage bond. So Reuben Dixon and his friend William Robertson are signing the bond saying that there's no legal barriers to him and Happy getting married. This one has the date conflict, though, exactly 1 year later. And it's not like the handwriting was hard to read. That clearly says 31. That clearly says 32. Don't know what's going on there. They got a license and they celebrated the 1 year anniversary of having the license by getting married. I don't know. But I'm going to make note of both dates, and I'm also going to make note of William Robertson. I don't know him, but I need to keep that name in my mind as I'm looking for Happy. These records are online on Ancestry. To me, they're not the same as scrolling through the actual microfilm, because you can't go forward and backward on Ancestry and know that you're really seeing adjacent records on the microfilm. That's why I use the quick and dirty index, and then I go grab the microfilm and look at the actual records here at TSLA. Okay. What if we had not gotten a match on that quick and dirty index? Could have started in Montgomery County records, done a more general search, maybe expanding, working my way out from counties adjacent to Montgomery. But we had a good result here. We found something. Okay, so now we've got Happy in 1831 or 32 in Dixon County. The next logical place to try to find her then is the 1840 census that I couldn't find her before in, but now she's going to be Mrs. Reuben Dixon. 1840 census is not going to list her by name. If she's married, it's going to list him more than likely as head of household. And sure enough, I was able to find in Stewart County, they've jumped counties again, 1840. Here's a Reuben Dixon. It looks to me like it's written R-H-E-B-A-N-D, Reuben, which may be what the census taker heard. But if we look at that data, it does fit with what we saw 10 years earlier with Happy. She was in her 20s there. Now she's in her 30s. We see that Reuben is also in his 30s. There's another piece of data here, though, that doesn't fit. There is a female between 10 and 15 years old who, therefore, she's older than the marriage. We don't know who she is, but it's a curiosity. Okay, so now we've jumped counties. We're in 1840. Let's go into the Stewart County records and see if we can find traces of Reuben Dixon or Happy Dixon. Okay. So far, we've just looked at the basic records. Like I said, I didn't find, I looked in 1850, I didn't find Happy Dixon or Reuben Dixon listed in any census, much less Stewart County. So what we really want to do is dig deeper into the resources here at TSLA. And that's what really this case study is about, is how do we keep track as we search through the vast collections here. I'm going to suggest to you that these categories on the main TSLA page are your checklist. Work your way through each of these categories, drilling down into the ones that make sense for whatever you're studying, to look through all of the records here at TSLA. So make this one of your checklists. I'm not going to drill down into all of these for the sake of time, but I'm going to touch on some of the ones that I like or where I found something. The first one up there says additional resources, and listed there are city directories and penitentiary records and postcards. I'm not going to look in city directories because she's off in Stewart County. There were no cities in Stewart County. I didn't look at postcards because I didn't in my mind think that I would find a postcard that had her name on it, right? I did look at penitentiary records. Pappy was not in the big house.
Okay. What about the husband?
I didn't find Reuben in the big house either. Okay. Based on the census data I have so far, I don't think Happy is African American, so I didn't drill down into that one for this particular project. Wonderful resources there, though, if you are researching someone that you think was a person of color or enslaved. Birth records. Let's jump down to birth records. Now, there are no birth records in Tennessee before 1908. I didn't make you answer that as a quiz question. But it's same as death records. But Bible records are here at TSLA, and this is how you find those. They're linked under the birth records. Wonderful collection of Bible records here online. And I don't show you a picture of it here, but there's a search engine where you can search by first name or last name or keyword. And what you'll find is that TSLA's Bible collection is not only indexed in a searchable database, but the original images are here as well. So from your computer at home or from the computer downstairs, you can now see the actual Bible pages. It's a great database. And the names in that database don't come up when you use the search engine. So you've got to go into that database, just like you do each of these databases, and do a search for whatever name you're looking for. I did search the Bible records. I did not find Happy listed in there. We've already looked at census records a bit, so let's drill down into county records. Click on county records, you find Big Star, one of my all-time favorite items that I use here a lot at TSLA, the inventory of county records on microfilm. the carousel that I showed you that has the paper booklets in there, one for every county. These inventories are also online, except for Knox County, and there has to be a story, Gordon, of why Knox County's is not online. But all of these records are also, the inventories are also online. And for me, this lets me do homework. I can pull these inventories while I'm sitting at home. I can make my shopping list so that when I get here, I can immediately start pulling microfilm. So let's drill down into county microfilm inventories. There's that carousel again. One for each county, including Knox, is here. Okay, Stewart County, that's where we last saw Happy and Reuben in the 1840 census. Every one of these booklets has a table of contents that shows you county by or court by court where to find the types of records. I show you as an example here that all the probate records for Stewart County are on page 5 of the inventory for that county. So here's another checklist. I'm looking for a name in a location. I don't know anything else than that. So I need to start looking at these reels of microfilm. But not every one of them is going to apply for this particular search. So this is a checklist too. Administrator's bonds. The date range is a little late for what I'm searching. I might come back to that one. But this next one, conservator's bonds from the 1950s and 60s, I don't need to look at that one, right? I'm researching someone in the 1840s and 50s. So you march your way through these inventories, noting ones you don't need to look at, ones you might want to come back to. You can do this in a number of ways. My favorite way is to print out that inventory and then just mark red lines through the ones I'm not going to look at. I use green lines for the ones I've already looked at, and then the others are the ones I still need to look at. So it can be a visual way to keep track. Make sure you're looking at everything that's here available so that you don't miss any records. Here in the Stewart County probate records, these last two, now these are ones I'm going to look at. In this county, the books called settlements also have the wills in them, not just the estate settlements. It's in the time period I'm interested in, so I'm going to pull these reels of microfilm. And sure enough, will book F on roll 53, which is the 1840 period, I find a Reuben Dixon on page 477. I don't know yet if this is the same Reuben Dixon I saw married to Happy, but I'm certainly going to crank on to page 477 and see what's there. And what's there is the will of a man named Reuben Dixon, written in 1844 and mentioning my wife Happy. All right, result. I have found Reuben Dixon, married to Happy, wrote his will in 1844. It was probated in 1847, so I know about when he died. Shortly after he died, his will would have been probated, but this county only met every 3 months, so that doesn't mean he died on October 1st or even September. He could have died a few months earlier. In his will, he leaves his wife Happy during her lifetime, all of his stuff, and then after her death, to be equally divided between Harriet Henry and Minerva Robertson. You remember that Robertson name we saw on the marriage license in Dixon County? It's probably a connection here. So this Robertson name I need to keep tucked in the back of my mind if I stumble on it later. Okay, but I have gotten this family story. I have found Happy in 1847 now. I've already mentioned, though, that I didn't find Happy or Reuben in the 1850 census. So I searched for Happy Dixon. She's now a widow. Just 3 years earlier, her husband had died. Logical place to look. Didn't find Happy Dixon anywhere at any time. So I've got to be prepared to make my search a little more generic. Okay. So I searched for just Happy, no last name. And hey, I found a record indexed for a woman named Happy Byram, Stewart County. That's the right place. I don't yet know exactly how old Happy is, but that 1808 fits with what I think I know so far about this. So that Byram last name, okay, that's a new name to me. So I immediately think maybe she got remarried between the time her husband died in 47 and this 1850 census. If this is her, then maybe she got married to a man whose last name was Byram. So here's that record. Happy Byram is how this was indexed. Now, I don't know what that says, But the person who chose to create that ancestry index indexed Byram as her last name. I don't think that's what's going on here. I think that the last name is Garrett, and that the person creating that index wasn't from around here and decided to index whatever that says as a last name. I think this is probably based on a biblical name. Happy was a nickname for one of Job's daughters, Karam Hapich, or something like that. So probably who she was named after. I still don't know what that says. But I get a little more information here. 1842, consistent with what we know so far about Happy that I'm researching. We get a birthplace, North Carolina. Hey, new information if it's our person we're looking for. Notice that she's living next door to a Self family. Wow. There's a little problem with that, though. She's younger than he is. He was born in Tennessee, and then the family moved back to North Carolina to have her. That doesn't make sense to me. But now I'm looking out not just for Robertson's, but I'm looking out for Henry Self, who apparently was one of Elizabeth Taylor's early husbands. Okay, so I think this is my Happy, but now married to a man named Garrett. So let's go look for a marriage record here in Stewart County to see if we can find Happy Dixon remarrying to Robert Garrett. Okay, so using the public computers downstairs, going to search Happy Dixon, 1848, Stewart County. Boom, found what I'm looking for. This isn't a quick and dirty index. It's a great index. But have you ever, ever, ever in your research found a person whose name was R-O-B-T-S? No. This is one of the reasons why I don't like these indexes. Because what the record actually says, to me it looks plain, R-O-B-T, and what maybe the index creator saw as an S is probably just a bleed through from the opposite page. But sure enough, we find Happy Dixon remarried Robert Garrett a few months prior to that 1850 census. So this is Happy. We have found her. She remarried after her first husband, Reuben Dixon, died. In this particular book, the right-hand side of the page was used to record when the marriage was solemnized. It's blank here. We can't assume that the marriage didn't take place. We can just assume that the minister's return was never reported back to the clerk. But we found her. We found her using a quick and dirty index. I probably could have found her if I went down to the reading room and used those published indexes like I tell you you need to be doing. But looking back at this census, now that we know it's her, where are those Robertson children? They were supposed to inherit whatever Happy had whenever she died, but they're nowhere to be found. Okay. It's a question. I'm accumulating questions, maybe more questions than answers here. So now from here, since census is easy to search, I'm going to go look at 1860 for Happy Garrett. Didn't find her. No Robert Garrett, no Happy Garrett. The census trail goes absolutely cold. But I've had a pretty good result looking in the county records so far. In marriage records, found a will. So let's keep working our way down the TSLA website and see what else we might look at to find more traces of Happy Self Dixon Garrett. Supreme Court cases are another wonderful database here on the TSLA website. You can do this from home by clicking either on court records. It's also linked here from the main archives page. Another great database that doesn't result if you type in the search engine. So you got to come here to this search engine for the Supreme Court records and do a search. Now, Happy has gone through several name changes. I'm going to give up on how many husbands she may be having, and I'm just going to search for Happy. You can narrow this search to a specific county, specific date range. I'm just going to say, give me everything you got. Now, there are about 10,000 boxes of Supreme Court records here in storage. They're still being processed, but this is a wonderful, wonderful way to access those records. What I really like about these records as well is if you're researching in a county where the court records have not survived, Montgomery County, circuit records don't survive much before 1900. But any case in Montgomery County that was appealed to Supreme Court is going to be here. So if you are searching in what you think is a Burn County and you haven't looked at the Supreme Court database, you're not done yet. Okay? Found there are a lot of Montgomery County cases to be found in the Supreme Court database that you can search from home. So I searched for Happy. I didn't find anything about her, but the nice thing about this search engine is it'll show you the word you've searched for in red letters, so they're easy to kind of process through. No mention of Happy, Self, Dixon, Garrett here, but the information is here for you to order a copy of any given case file from TSLA if you need to see that case, if something jumps out here at you. They've got a form on the website where they ask for this information, and for a small fee, they'll photocopy that case and send it to you. I found some wonderful things in the Supreme Court database here, but I didn't find Happy. Moving on down the list, divorce records. There are also indexes of divorce records here on the website. They were mainly early on done through either a petition to the legislature or the actual act of the legislature. There is an index here on the website. I don't show you a case of it here. Again, early on, the legislature would issue a divorce, but later on, it was more common for either the circuit court or the chancery court in the county to issue a divorce. So you would really need to go look at those county records unless you're looking at something really early for a divorce. Using this index, I did not find any evidence of Happy and Robert Garrett getting a divorce. I'm going to move down to the manuscript selection. This is probably maybe the largest part of, if maybe second only to the county records, the largest part of TSLA's microfilm collection. If you click on manuscripts, you will see a list of about 2,000 manuscript collections that are here, none of which you will find anything about if you use the search engine. What you really need to do is look at each of these by number, and I'll show you an example of what those look like. Here's numbers 17 through 21, wide variety of records that are here at TSLA that you need to look at. Polk papers from a Revolutionary War soldier, diaries from the 1840s and 50s in Shelbyville, field notes from an engineer who was on the Mississippi line in the 1890s or 1860s and 70s, and then church records from Wayne County. Wide variety of collections there that you need to look at. I'm looking for a woman in Stewart County in the middle 1800s. I have not made my way through all 2,000 of these collections yet, trying to see which ones are relevant to my search and which are not, but you need to do that. If you haven't done that yet, you're not finished looking for whoever you're searching for. These descriptions will come back in the search engine. So if you're searching a county or a name, you can hit that search engine, and if it appears in the description that TSLA has prepared, you'll find it. But if Loyal Walter Murphy's field notes lists everybody in the county he lived in, their names are not going to be in that search engine. You need to pull that reel of microfilm and just crank through it and see what you can find. These collections can vary from one reel to hundreds of reels. So military records. So if you click on military research, and then I'm looking for someone who was in the 1840s, 1850s, she may have lived through the Civil War. So I do need to drill down into that. I don't need to drill down into World War II to look for Happy. But when you click on military research, Civil War, a wonderful collection of records that you can go through. Some of these are online databases. Some of them are finding aids to other collections here at TSLA. The one that I want to jump to and brag on is at the very bottom of this list, Union Provost Marshal records from Tennessee. During the time that Tennessee was occupied in the Civil War, the Union Army had provost marshals who were the law and order for the occupied areas. They maintained order for both soldiers and civilians. This is a wonderful place to find mention of civilians in the Civil War, which can be a very hard thing to do. An even harder thing if you're looking for an enslaved person or a free person of color. But you have a better chance of doing it in the provost marshal records than most any other Civil War collection you will find. It is worth your time to search through this collection. There are two parts to this collection. One for individual civilians, 300 reels of microfilm downstairs on records of individual civilians. But that one's easy to search. It's arranged alphabetically by surname. So it wasn't too bad for me to find each of the 300 rolls that had Dixon, self, and Garrett on it, looking for Happy to see if there was a record created by the provost marshal during this time. I didn't find any, but it's easy to search. The one that's not easy to search is the second one, which is the papers relating to two or more civilians. So more than one person getting involved with the provost marshal's office. There is an awful index, a very rudimentary index on reel one of that collection, and that is 1607 downstairs. But TSLA has done a wonderful, wonderful thing to this great collection. They have indexed the Tennessee records for this collection. So if you're researching someone who lived in the Civil War, you need to come to this database and search for your person by first name, last name, or keyword, and see what you find. Easy to do. You can do it on the public computers here. You can do it from home. Wonderful way to access this amazing collection. So I searched for Happy Garrett. No results. As I have been saying, make your search more generic if you need to, if you don't have results. So let's just search Happy in these provost marshal records and see what we find. Hey, we have a result. 1863, right time period. Fort Donelson, absolutely the right location. Stewart County, this is where we last left Happy in 1850 census. There is a record. And this isn't only an index to the provost marshal records. The actual images are also part of this database. You see the right-hand side, you can click on PDF image. You can open up the actual documents from this collection. The thing to keep in mind here is that this is a multi-page PDF file. So when you open the document, you're looking at page one. What you're really looking for might be on page 14. Don't forget that you have to scroll down through that document. So let's see what we found about Happy Dixon in the Provost Marshal in 1863. Happy Dixon and Mariah Odom are hereby ordered to leave the premises within 24 hours after reception of this order, and if again found within 30 miles of this post, will be arrested to hard labor and on the fortifications, then confined in the penitentiary. I think you probably know what's going on here, why these women were being ordered to get away from Fort Donelson. As an additional clue, this collection, file number 4957, actually had orders to 10 women with the same instructions, get away from the post. So this is not Happy Garrett, this is Happy Dixon, but it's got to be her. I don't know what happened to Mr. Garrett. I never found her, but there it is. Okay. Maybe a reason why he died was the comment. Okay. The trail, I will tell you, for Happy ran cold after this 1863 record. I could not find her in anything after 1863. But I have another name now to research, Mariah Odom. They may have known each other at work. Maybe office mates there. I was able to find a little more about Mariah, and sure enough, 5 years later, after the war is over, still here in Stewart County, Mariah is indicted by the grand jury for keeping a house of ill fame. She was acquitted, though. She was acquitted. But I will also point out that 7 years after this, in the 1870 census, I do find Mariah, head of household, no man in sight, and a string of children. So it's probably what we suspect is probably true that was going on here. But what a wonderful record that you're able to find. And you would never find this by cranking through hundreds of reels of microfilm if it weren't for the index that TSLA has created and put online. You can do these searches yourself very easily and find some remarkable, remarkable documents. We're looking at provost marshal records here, and on that topic, I want to show you one other provost marshal record that is not part of this collection. It is number 822 in the microfilm collection downstairs, and it is a separate reel of provost marshal records from Montgomery County, not part of that other collection that we were looking for. The original of this is with the Historical Museum in Clarksville. It does say restricted here, so I don't think I could transcribe this and make a book out of it. But I do want to point this out to you, and I'll show you why it's important. Yeah, this is a very specific collection. It says Confederate prisoners held in Clarksville, but it's more than that. Here's an example of what's in that reel of microfilm. Prisoners confined at Clarksville, but look at their residences. Alabama, Stewart County, Montgomery County, Robertson County, Caldwell County, Kentucky. If you were a descendant of Mr. A. Sisk of Caldwell County, Kentucky, would you go looking in Clarksville for traces of your ancestor? No, you wouldn't. So that's why you need to know about this reel of microfilm, is prisoners could have come from a wide variety of places. So if you haven't looked at this one yet, and you're researching in the Civil War time frame, you need to. It's not indexed, it's not a huge roll of microfilm, but it could be worth your while. It's also interesting to see what charges these folks were held by the Provost Marshal in Clarksville for. Horse stealing, guerrilla, rebel spy, capturing Union man. There are persons of color in here as well, right? So doesn't say why they were state prisoners, but persons of color are also in this collection. And something I found that I had not seen before in this collection that was amazing to me is one of the prisoners of the Provost Marshal was Virgil Earp. And yes, that is Wyatt's brother. He was in the 83rd Illinois, which was the unit that was garrisoned in Dover and Clarksville during the Civil War. And he was thrown in jail for stealing money. Now, I had not heard that before. I wanted to know, do other people know this, or is this a well-kept secret? I did a bit of an internet search for Virgil Earp, and most of those records say he was court-martialed, comma, probably for fighting. So not a lot of information out there about the reason he was court-martialed, and here it is on a roll of microfilm downstairs. Now, this is not secret. One of the big Civil War roundtable supporters and fountains of knowledge in Clarksville, Randy Rubel, did share this information out to the internet a number of years ago. I did find mention of that, but you just never know what you're going to find when you're going through these records. I will also mention that in this same collection, I found one of my ancestors, Chesley Bridgewater, who was in jail for being drunk. He was one of my harder ancestors to track down, and so I was thankful to find out that at least he was alive and drunk in jail in Clarksville during the Civil War. Okay, one more record set I want to bring your attention to on the TSLA website. If you hover over our library and archives, click on Archives Development, and then click on the Tennessee Archives Directory, you're going to find a very handy map of all of the county archives in the state. Whether they have an active archives in blue, a partial archives in green, or they haven't gotten there started yet. There's an immense collection here at TSLA, but not everything is here. They haven't microfilmed everything. So yes, you do also need to work in the county you're researching in. This is a great way to link to a county archives that you need to go research in. I'll show you Montgomery County Archives here, some great information that is going to help you quickly get to that resource, physical address, phone numbers, email address, and even a link to Jill's website to take you to her website to show you the records that she has. Which is going to be different records than you may find here in TSLA, so you need to do both. Thousands and thousands of microfilm reels here, but it's not all here. You also need to work with your local county archives to find out things about that. I will mention that I was researching at Jill's archives just a couple of weeks ago, seeing if I could find anything about Happy Self Dixon Garrett up there that I hadn't been able to find here in TSLA. I was looking at an every name index that had been prepared for some of the records up there, and a new family tree of mine fell out of that book. I'd been researching that county for 36 years, and I found a new surname in there just because of a locally prepared index to the original records. So that's why it's important to look for those locally prepared indexes and use them as a jumping off point to get into the original records. So the questions that I had on Happy, I still don't know if Self was her maiden name. I did find that their self name is very common in Dixon County in the early time period, so I could go to the Dixon County Archives maybe and do a little more research there. I do know more about her family. I know two of her husbands. I do know kind of what happened to her, at least up till the provost marshal had a talk with her. I don't know what happened to her second husband, Robert Garrett. He just drops off the face of the earth. But just with the records here at TSLA, the databases that are online, the microfilm that's here, got a pretty good start. Long way to go, lots of microfilm left to explore. But I made a pretty good stab at figuring out more about Happy Self that I started out on. So in summary, in this case study, we saw census and marriage records, easy way to get a research started. Don't forget about the public computers that have the Heritage Quest census records that you can get to from home. Look for those local indexes as a way to get to the original records. March your way down through the TSLA website categories to make sure you're looking at everything that's here. A few of the favorites that I mentioned there you see listed. And then lastly, don't forget about using the county archives via this archives directory to go look for more records that may not be here. Okay. At that point, I am going to say thank you, and I will be glad to take any questions that I can answer that you may have.
Can you access that with your own computer when you're in the building? Or does it have to be on one of the...
The ProQuest database has to be accessed on the computers that are here. If you bring your laptop with you, you can't get to it that way. You have to, even though you're physically here and logged into their Wi-Fi, you have to use the public computers downstairs. But it's a wonderful database, as I hope I convinced you.
If I understood the lady correctly, some of your these lectures are going to be available through the TSLA. Will that be pretty obvious to find when we're...
I would assume that Gordon is going to put an announcement on the TSLA website when the videos are available. And the TSLA friends that have sponsored some of these workshops already do have videos on their website as well. TSLAfriends.org is that
okay.
Address.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions? Go ahead. So did y'all hear that question? A census form with her ancestor that has the word bastard written out beside of it, what does that really mean? That's a good question. I would recommend that you might look in the county records of that county where the census was taken to see, because sometimes in that situation, the father was forced to sign a bond to the county promising that he would not allow that child to become a financial burden on the county. He would have to make a bond for that, so you might go looking for that bond. They were called bastardy bonds.
Yeah. Sometimes in the search it takes you to other states, can some of these techniques be used for other state libraries? Is Tennessee unique in that it has so much index and so much information, or when I go across the state line to Kentucky, will it translate well there or not?
So the question was, I hope I've impressed you with how much is available on TSLA's website. The question is it that way for all states? No. I'm a native Tennessean. My folks have always lived here. I'll always brag on TSLA. And I'll also quote my friend Mark Lowe, who says, when you're doing research, as we all know, you start in the county courthouse, unless you're in Tennessee and you start at the state archives in Nashville. A testament to how great a resource this is and how much is online. Now, it does vary by state. I'll brag on Missouri for having death certificates online. They're doing a wonderful project there, but it really does vary widely from state to state what they have chosen to digitize, what they've had the funding to digitize and put online so that we can conveniently get to it from home. It really does vary.
On that iconic picture that you had, usually those pictures are nice when they have visitors. And so the one that we stop at one time, and you
go back and look at the records. He may have been a visitor from another lot.
Okay. Okay, so that's a very good point. Thank you. The observation was that the reason all of the lodge members may have been dressed up in their robes and best is they may have had a visitor that day. And so it's possible that some of the people in the photo were a visitor. It's possible that my ancestor was visiting a different lodge and I'm in the completely wrong lodge altogether. Great. Could have been a funeral as well. That's a good point. Yeah. Anyone else? Okay, I appreciate your time. Let's all adjourn downstairs and get to cranking on the microfilm.